Good morning and welcome to this morning worship. I was talking to my worship team this morning and I said, this is a Sunday that pastors dread. The fall Sunday is the pastor's love and the spring forward Sunday is the pastor's dread. Because if you don't set your clock, you'll be here for benediction. But if on a fall, if you don't set your clock, you will be 1 hour early for service. So, welcome. Thank you for joining us in worship. If you're here in the sanctuary, we want to say a big welcome to you. If you are worshiping with us online, we want to say a welcome to you as well. Thank you again for worshiping. Let me read a portion of scripture for you, and then I will pray, and then we will get started. The assigned portion of scripture is from Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy for the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home and a swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your houses, ever singing praises. Happy are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. Then later on he says, for a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. God, we give you thanks. God, may we with the psalmist say, oh God, it is better to be here. It's better to be in the house of the Lord. And God, 1,000 days elsewhere. And God, we thank you again for bringing us together in worship. And Lord, here you are more than present to worship with us. And so God, continue to be with us as we worship you. As we meditate on scripture. As we meditate on the things that you have called us to do. And Lord, when we leave this place and we go to wherever you will take us this week. And may we be ready to serve you. May we be ready to share something that we have with others who don't. And so God, I pray a blessing over all that we will do. For those of us who are gathered here, we give you thanks. For those who are still driving, we pray for safe passage for them as you bring them together in worship. Lord, just help us to just enjoy your presence this morning, for you are here and you are worthy to be praised. We thank you, we bless you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If the worship team will just come up here and then we can do our call to worship. If you will stand with me, let's do our call to worship. The Lord is sovereign. Let the people tremble in awe. God is enthroned between the cherubim. Let the earth shake. The Lord is great in Zion. God is high above all peoples. Come, let us worship our glorious Lord.
Good morning, church. How's everyone doing? For a moment over there, yes. As Pastor said, even I was scared. Maybe we're going to play music to the pews. But thank you for joining. At least we know who set their alarm clocks or, you know it's DST or something. Alrighty. So if you haven't been following, Pastor's been leading a Lenten season Bible study. And it's very interesting what I found, right? So when you think about Peter, when you think about, you know, all the disciples, you know, you would think they're superheroes, they're perfect, nothing could go wrong. But really, the way Pastor explained it was hilarious, and it still comes to my mind, right? It was a ragtag team, as Pastor would say, of imperfectionists, right? A fisherman, a zealot, and a tax collector, right? Nothing in common. But you know what? Even though they were imperfect in whatever they did, the perfection only came through Christ Jesus. Amen? All right, let's start a praise and worship today.
Thank you. should sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Jesus, in your name we pray, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength
more.
God, we give you thanks. Take a minute to think of all that you said this morning through worship. God, holy are you, and you have come to dwell with us. God, you have come to save us. A few weeks from now, oh God, the people will journey to Jerusalem, and you will ride on that donkey, and you will go into that city, and people who followed you before and people who followed you after will shout out with their loud voice saying, Hosanna, the one who is coming, the coming King. God, the one who will come to save us. But there's so many things that we said, oh God, sometimes we don't even have a minute to think of these things. God, even the last verse, it says so beautifully, it says, and with ransom and glory, his face I at last shall see. It'll be my joy through the ages, the song of his love for me. I want just the worship team to just lead that one stanza and we will close with that. But I wanted to talk about, you know, oftentimes, now for me, probably you might say, Pastor, for you, this is what you do. But I want to challenge you this morning. Do you stand amazed in this love of God that has redeemed you? You know, the scripture so beautifully says, isn't it? It says that God redeemed us not when we got our act together. God doesn't meet Zacchaeus when he decides to give. God meets Zacchaeus on the road and he says, Zacchaeus, I need to come and stay with you. God met everyone, the woman at the well. Jesus never said to her, you got to get your act straight. Jesus came to that woman, spoke to her in a way that she could not believe. And even this morning, God's desire is to redeem us from where we are. You to just, you know, don't let this moment pass by. And even if you just have to stop and say, God, I'm sorry I didn't take much time this morning to stay in your presence. I got hurried. I was running away. There's so many things that happened, but here I am. I want to just stay in this moment, in this place, at this moment, and I want to say you, I want to stand amazed at your love. I want to stand amazed because you have redeemed me. Each one of you who are standing in this place and those of you who are watching us online, you have experienced God's amazing love, and say that to God. And I stand amazed. Go to the last one and with the ransom. Your mercy has redeemed me, and here I stand in all of my righteousness because of what you did for me on the cross. And I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you. And God, I rest of our time in worship together. And even, oh God, this morning as we stand in your presence, we together with all of the saints who have gone before us and those who live among us, oh God, we say that prayer of confession together. Shall we say it together? The prayer of confession. Shall we say it together? Though we want to walk with Moses and see God's holy radiance, we hide in the midst of our own desires, unable to perceive the presence of God's grace. While we went, justice and peace walk in the cloud of selfishness, unable to share God's loving kindness. Though we want to follow Jesus up the mountain, we cower in fear, unable to bear the light of God. And amen. God reassures you and me this morning in the blazing light of God's grace. Jesus touches us to say, get up, do not be afraid. In the name of Christ, you and I are forgiven. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the lessons.
The first reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 58. Verses 6 to 9, the first part of verse 9. Isaiah chapter 58, verses 6 to 9, the first part of verse 9. Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, here I am. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from 1 Peter chapter 4, 10 through 11. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 through 11. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Christ Jesus. To him belongs the power, the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Here ends the second lesson.
Before the children leave for Sunday school, there are a few who are here. I just want to say a prayer with them, and then I will let them go. Danny, Adi and Daniel, has his birthday on the 13th. Athena is here somewhere. She's there, 13th. Jufel is here. Jufel, not yet, okay. Jufel celebrates his birthday on the 14th. Nathaniel, Gerald, Auntie, if you're watching us from Florida, we want to pray and we want to wish Nathaniel a happy birthday on the 18th. Jacob, Samuel, Moses, please wish Jacob for us. He celebrates his birthday on the 18th. Anshu and Varsha celebrate their anniversary on the 18th. So I just want to invite them and I will pray. Shall we pray together? God, we give you thanks this morning for all your goodness, for your grace, for your mercy, and for your faithfulness especially, oh God. And faithfulness that meets us every time, even before we pray. God, there are so many things that you did in the life of each one of them who are standing here, whether it's an anniversary or a birthday. God, it is your grace, it is your faithfulness that has brought them to this place. And Lord, like the psalmist says, if it God not been on our side, Israel knew, oh God, that it's your faithfulness in their life has brought them thus far. And so here they stand, oh God, Danny, Athena, Jufel, Nathaniel, Jacob, Varsha, and Anshu. And God, they want to mark this day mark this week, mark this year, and say to you, God, we are grateful. And then they want to look ahead and say, God, you've been with us in the past. And you will be with us, oh God, as we enter into this new year. And God, may the God of the past continue to be with them, walk with them this new year, oh God. May they sense your presence and the closeness of you, oh God. Because over and over again, you remind us that you are Emmanuel, God with us. And so to that God, we commit them. And we send them into this new year with your blessing. And God, take care of them and bless this year for them. For we pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Children may leave for Sunday school. Before I invite Bobby to do the announcements, want to invite this morning Dr. Ruth Manorama. She's here. I've heard of her name because my cousin and Dr. Ruth were great friends. I've heard of you, but we've never met. We are here. And she does a lot of ministry among women in India. And she's here visiting Pastor Kumar, and Auntie and Preeti Auntie and Pastor Dr. Manorama are great friends. And so she's here, and she'll share some of the things that she does. And then I'll invite Bobby to do the announcements.
Reverend Kamlesh, Stephen Kamlesh, and all the church congregation, and my friends Preeti and Kumar, suddenly he told me that I've done a mistake. I hope you forgive me in the morning. I said, what? I asked Reverend, 5 minutes from the service to say a few words about your work. I said, not at all a problem. If Kumar asks, I will definitely do it. We are, friends for 40 years. And Preeti and myself work together under the same roof. It's called the International Grail, a project in India. We work together. And Preeti was my senior. She's a coordinator. I was looking after all community development programs there. And Kumar is not less. Kumar is a student Christian movement in Chennai. He was the program officer when we are growing. So that friendship and, love for families, the kind of, commitment that we, the work that we did, we have remained faithful to each other and to God. So I really praise God. Whenever I come here for some meetings, in fact, visiting of Preeti and is usually the agenda, linked with other things. So I usually come here to the United Nations meeting. The whole world today, 198 countries, are thinking about how do we empower women? How do we, the older words are, how do we really free women or emancipate women? Now the new word for that is, how do we empower women? The world is going through difficult times and good times. Like we are not unlike before, we are in a digital age. So how do we make use of the digital age to push women's issues, to push women's, you know, empowerment in the world? So we come to this meeting because this is a place we learn what are the countries are, what are the countries are thinking about, like, you know, how to develop, you know, or develop strategies, develop programs and policies in order to empower women. Because you know that in all the countries, you know, with all the developments in the world that has taken place, women are really still, you know, treated as second-class citizens. We have to be always dependent on somebody else. We don't have self-reliance. And, you know, still we have to be under with someone. Like, so people are thinking, how do we develop, you know, women's leadership in governance, in countries? How do women participate? How do they serve, you know, families, communities, whatever the institution they are in? So there is a knowledge creation is done at the UN. So we participate in that. What are the each government saying? What are they bringing? What Indian government is thinking about empowering women? So because that is linked up with my work back in Bangalore. And I work in, you know, at a national level, created many organizations, and we are working. So we have to work out strategies from the global to local. We have to bring it down. So how do we simplify this effect? Because Karnataka is one country, India is one country where they send, you know, IT professionals all over the world. Yeah. So how do we strengthen the IT interventions in order to promote more, you know, empowerment for women? So there are doubts. The global context is one thing. You know what is happening. There are wars everywhere, and people are discussing about that. There are corruption, terrorism. These are, you know, quite big issues they're talking about. In that, they're also talking about women's empowerment. Today in India, there are a lot of policies, programs for Indian women. Government is also spending money. But the thing is, the atmosphere is not so good. The violence, you know, that perpetrated on women is so high. During Corona time, COVID time, the National Crime Bureau had said the increase on violence against women. So women were there in the families, 24/7 in houses. Like, you know, what happened? Women, there were a lot of health issues. You know that we have supplied medicines to all the countries, Modi. And, you know, Prime Minister sent medicine because he thought that by doing that, he will be like, you know, India, he wanted to show India shining. Yes, India shines, but, you know, India shines on one side, the other side it is dark. So we see that, mediate there, how do we bring these benefits to the poor people, people who are in the slums, people who are in the villages, how do they get, you know, empowered? So we have supplied, you know, medicines, you know, we have supplied food. We demanded government that the people do not have jobs, whether government could provide food security. Myself and my husband, we have a group there. So we have really negotiated with government. We said that at least 10,000 rupees for family should be given. And we have said that women who work as domestic workers should be given at least 2,000 per month. That's very little, but at least they will have some money in their own hands. So so we see to that we'll make a bridge between government and people in, you know, bringing those programs to them, either housing, basic communities, health situation, education for children, you name it, you know, we are in everything. Human rights for women. I think we are also saying that women should be allowed to make their own choices. Women should participate in churches, in communities, in government, local level, you know, at all levels. I also belong to a party, Janata Dal Secular. He must be known, Devu Gowda, you know. So I belong to their party. He has invited me because of my work to strengthen their women in the party. So now the elections are coming. I'm also helping them, asking them, demanding the party to give 1/3 reservation for women in, you know, giving seats to them. So I had to get back because elections are coming in April. Next year is a parliamentary election. So our work is socio-economic and political work. See to that in all this, how women could benefit and how women could, you know, really enjoy dignity, how women could enjoy freedom, how do they enjoy you know, leadership positions. So these are my work, and I've been doing almost for 40 years. I'm because of this work, I am known in the government. I sit in policy-making levels. What we think, what people want, we take it to the government and commissions and everything. So I've been in many committees working there. So, this is the work that I do. And I come here, I learn. I was sharing with them last night. In our country, still people do not have food. They don't go to school. And though, you know, education indicators have developed quite well. We have come up to, you know, from zero, we have come up to 37%, 42% in some countries. And here, I mean, there are women and women, but I concentrate on women who are discriminated more in terms of resources. Like, you know, our country is also quite divided on the base of class, caste, and gender. India is going through a bit of a problem. They want to make India an Hindutva country, you know, one religion, one people, one language. So everybody has to read Sanskrit. Everybody has to do Hindi. The diversity, the plurality of India is forgotten. You know, everything our Chief Prime Minister want to make one. We have this G20. You know that there is a big, you know, attack on people like us who are working. They think that we are dividing the country. In fact, we are developing the poor. We are serving the poor without much, you know, much ado. So this is our humble work that has created, you know, a lot of ripples and, you know, kind of impacted people. The ordinary women are able to stand up and talk and say that this is what we want. You don't make decisions. You don't make decisions to clear up our, you know, settlements. We will be here because we are here for 40 years. So we will also help them legal education. Now I have to go and start programs with the young people. I've created already 100 ambassadors, women young ambassadors between 18 to 35. So digital, you know, digital education we will give means you have to provide phones, smartphones, and, you know, computers. We are also working on policies. So this is my work, and it's very interesting, though it is very hard. So in all this, you know, I never go and preach about God and all that. Today you see that a lot of my people have become Christians, you know, because they think that something in me that inspires them. So God is there with us. Like, if God is on our side, who can deny, you know, our rights? I think that is the... So my work is related to the faith because I'm a Christian. I think I have an obligation to preach the good news to the poor. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. All right. First and foremost, thank you so much again for your wonderful presence today, and you in the sanctuary, and also people on the Zoom. Thanks, everyone. And today, before I start, I just want to welcome any newcomers today, any visitors with us. Yeah. I think I've seen you before. Is that second time, sister? Is it first time? Okay. Can you please introduce Jill? Yeah.
This is my sister Valerie, everybody. Hello. My first time here. Very happy to be here. I've known Joanna for a long time. I'm married. I have three children. I'm an occupational therapist. I'm an author. And I've been walking with the Lord. Actually, my 15th anniversary of my baptism will be in a couple of days.
Wow.
So,
thank you so much. Thanks. And if anyone online, you're joining us today for the first time, you are very much welcome. We appreciate your presence too. The choir practice will be after service. Angie will do the practice. The children, about 11 years, for the Palm Sunday song, special song, followed by the adult choir, right? Okay. And on the regional song side, Ainsha, yeah, he's here, and actually he has selected a lot of regional songs. Hope you're part of the WhatsApp group. If you want to be part of it, let Ainsha know that he will also include you. And there are a lot of songs he has selected, wonderful songs in Indian languages, Tamil, Kannada, Malayalam, Telugu. So if anybody wants to, you know, be part of that choir, please contact Ainsha. Ainsha, you have any schedule for the practice? Okay, right. Thank you, Ainsha. We have a daily morning prayer at 6 a.m. every day. Thank you so much, first and foremost, for all the people who are diligently, you know, coming for the prayer every day. Almost we have done 1 year, Pastor. More than a year we have done that, and kudos to everybody. And first and foremost, thanks be to God that he has put in that desire in all of us. The Lenten Bible study is done every Friday. This Friday, again, at 7:30 p.m., we have the Bible study. And it's been a pretty interesting study, I would say, regarding that Uber Amar Gao. Okay, I got it. So that and what God is doing in that village is amazing. And pastor is doing a study on the community activities that being done, not just like 10 years or 20 years, it's been going like 400 years. So we have to learn a lot from that kind of commitment. Please, first and foremost, thank you so much for the for all you for attending the Friday Bible study every Friday. So also encourage others to join. There are some dates that I just want to remind you. Tuesday, March 14th, this Tuesday, okay, we have the our involvement in the Messy Church Ministry, which is in a church in Bridgewater, very close to Bridgewater. And the team, the praise and worship team, headed by Sunil, we'll go and help them out this Tuesday. So if anyone interested, again, that you are very much welcome. And for the address and all the information, you can contact Pastor. April 6th, we have a Maundy Thursday service at 7:30 p.m. We provide a cedar meal and also Holy Communion on the service. Friday, April 7th, Good Friday service. At noon, we have usual service, and we have pastors, and they are coming up with seven words for the service, and pastor will have more announcement on that later, and all the regional songs will be sung on the service. April 29th, we have a marriage couples retreat. Again, for more information, please contact pastor for now. And June 23rd, we have the church annual retreat. It's the 25th church annual retreat. The speaker is a well-renowned speaker in India. His name is Gabriel Thomas Raj, Reverend Gabriel Thomas Raj. Please mark your calendar. It's a very, very important retreat that we have right now with a very good preacher, so I wouldn't want anyone to miss it. Then, regarding the triune, the April edition is going to go out, but we need all the articles by March 20th. Okay, so we encourage all of you to participate in that, write the articles, poems, whatever that you can think of that will really edify others. Please send that to Purna. He's a coordinator for that, and that is for the April edition, all right? Finally, we have the fellowship hours every week. After the service, please stay back. Thank you.
Thanks, Bobby. I always think of this one. Usually after somebody speaks, there is an applause. Bobby walks up, there was an applause. So that's how popular Bobby is. Bobby, thank you so much for... you don't know how nervous he was. Not because he was standing before you, but what will happen when he gets home. Thank you, Bobby, for doing that. Thank you, Dr. Manorama, for your whatever you shared. And it's such a, and I thought it was, we're going through a series, and I will say a little bit more in my sermon, but it meant a lot from what you said. And the work that you do, sometimes it's thankless work, but the impact that you make at the grassroots level. And oftentimes when we do things as a church, we think it should be this glorious thing, or we think it needs to have an impact of 10,000 people or 1,000 people, but we don't realize that it takes only a spark to get the fire going. So I think what you do is very important. And when you go back home, when you go back to doing your work, tell the people who work with you that there is a small church in New Jersey that will pray for them. Thank you for what you do. Thank you so much. Thank you for those of you who attend our Lenten Bible studies. And I told the group that met, if there is one goal for that Bible study, is by the end of the Bible study, you will be able to say the name of that village, Ober Ammergau. So that's all I want, whether you get anything out of it or not. And if I ask you, Pastor, hey, what did we do? Ober Ammergau. Oh, if you say that, yeah, I have. That's my yardstick with which I will. But thank you, Valerie, for being with us this morning. And thank you for worshiping with us. You will be in our prayers as well. Thank you. Thank you, Aarti. Just pray for Aarti. She's done with all her clearance and she's ready to start. What she does is tremendously important. It was a long break for Aarti after they moved from New York. And so she starts back again at Morristown. And I think now you need to talk to her, because what the work that she does, she could have picked something else, but felt God calling her to this particular task. And it's fantastic what the work that she will do, and continue to commit Aarti in God's care. So if you have a prayer request, if there is somebody who is not well, we pray for Peterson, and I remember John, we pray for your dad, Amrit Raj. And if you have a prayer request that you want me to pray with you, yes, Joanna. How old is
Nora? Is now four.
Four. She's tiny. Okay. Okay. Yeah. We will pray. Uncle, yeah.
My cousin, Glory Christopher, she suddenly passed away after a massive heart attack yesterday in Bangalore.
Pray for the family. Sure. It's nice to have you in worship. We've been praying for you. Kumar uncle, we've been praying for you, and I know we talked about last week. I announced and I said, hey, keep him in prayer, he's not doing so well. So good to see you.
Thank
in
you.
Worship. Any other prayer requests that you have? If somebody is, I know Leslie is traveling this week, and keep him in prayer as well. If there are other requests that you have, you can shout it out. Yeah, Angeline, keep Angeline in prayer. Her shoulder is hurting, and the doctor said she doesn't need any more treatment. It just has to heal by itself. So that's what she needs to do. She needs to rest and get healed. So we'll keep you in prayer. Moses? Okay, we'll do. We'll do. If there are no prayer requests, will we bow our heads in prayer? God, we thank you, God, for bringing people and giving them a heart to share what they are doing. And Lord, it's so appropriate that we could hear what Dr. Manorama is doing, and for the work that she just, for the passion, Lord, when she stood here, the passion, the commitment, the love for the people. And so, God, I pray a blessing over the work that she does. I pray that she would continue to use her hands and, Lord, her heart. And, Lord, that you would extend your kingdom, Father. And you do it in such a beautiful way. And all you ask us to offer are gifts to you. Because you love the world that you created more than we do. And so, God, you will never let go of your mission in this world. And so, God, I thank you for people like Dr. Manorama and the things that she does, and for the group that works with her. And there are so many in grassroots level, oh God, are empowering children and women, and we pray for them wherever they are. And we pray a blessing over them, oh God. Thank you for this church and for inviting people like Valerie to come and be a part of our fellowship to share what God is doing in her life. And there are many others, oh God, who are here. Some of them probably are online, and we give you thanks. God, we pray a blessing over all that we do in terms of children's ministry, the teens, the young people, the college going, and the adults, for Bible studies that we meet, for the prayers that we do in the morning. So many things, oh God, that you do it so graciously. All you ask us is to just be available. And Lord, oftentimes we think that we need to be the most successful, but Lord, you again remind us to call to be faithful. And Lord, you, even in our Bible study, you reminded us, oh God, you just picked 12 people who are not the greatest, who didn't have the greatest gift, but yet you saw something in them. And even for us, oh God, as we stand before you this morning and say to you, God, here I am, send me. Here I am, send me to touch the world that is in need. And you will use us as a church. You will use us as individuals. You will use us as families. And so I pray, oh God, that teach us to make those small commitments. That's all you require of us. And so, God, we thank you. We pray that all of us who are seated here at the end of this worship, oh God, that they will make a commitment before you. Because it's about you and what you do. It's not about the greatest things, oh God. It's the most ordinary and the simple things. And God, because the world needs people who can do that extra bit, who can walk that extra mile with somebody who's hurting. And so, God, we thank you. And we pray a blessing over them. Lord, we continue to pray for people like Aarti, who you have called, and it's a calling. And she has said yes, and that you will use her. God, we continue to pray for those among us who are not well. For Angeline, for Nora, for Mr. Amrit Raj, for Peterson, for Hilda Aunty and her brother, Durai. And God, there are so many others. For being with Kumar Uncle and just invite, bringing him to worship this morning, we give you thanks. There are so many others, oh God, and I... Even this morning, as I pass before you, and in the quietness of their heart, the people will raise those names. And when they do it, God, you hear. You listen. You just not only hear, you listen. And you meet us. And so, God, even as I pass before you, God, the names that were raised, God, we pray that you would meet them wherever they are. Thank you, God, for somebody like Joshua. And Lord, we continue to commit people like Angeline, for whom just rest is what they need. And I pray, oh God, that you would continue to be and heal them. And we thank you for doing that. God, in the midst of those, in all of those things that happen, we continue to experience death and grief for the family of Glory. And Lord, as the family grieve through this process, oh God, there's only one source of peace, and that's you. You say it over and over again, I have come to give you peace unlike the world. And so, God, we pray for peace for them as the grieving families. And even in the process, there are so many whom we have lost in these past years or even this year. Oh God, we give you thanks and we pray a blessing over them. And God, we pray that you would continue to be with them. For our young people who are in college, and Lord, the semester is, sometimes it's almost coming to the end of the semester or in the middle of it, and there's so much work that's going on, they are overwhelmed, and God, I pray for wisdom for them, wherever they are. Continue to bless them, oh God. For those who have finished college and are looking for jobs, I pray that you would open doors for them. We thank you again for bringing us together in worship this morning. God, our needs are so many. But we remember those who are poor and migrant workers and the homeless, the hungry, the fatherless. God, we pray for all of them this morning. Continue to be with us as we read your word, as we sit on it. But we want to hear you speak. Use me, my voice, and all that I offer, oh God. So bless the rest of our time. Every prayer, oh God, spoken and unspoken, we gather it in your name. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's time to bring your offertory, your tithes and offerings. Shall we rise?
Yeah.
the tune. It's not an unfamiliar one. So sing it with us. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, beginning from verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and its clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said, "don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Don't tell anyone what you've seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Again, God, give you thanks for the word which will come alive for us. For you are the word that made flesh and dwells among us even now. So God, we thank you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Just one quick announcement and then I will share. Like we always do, we have confirmation classes. This year, as of now, I have a shining star. And Anish will take the journey with me. If you know someone who is, even if they are not part of this church, but is willing to take that journey with us, we will start not this week, we will start from next week. And our confirmation will not be on the Pentecost Sunday, because I think it believes that falls on the long weekend, so we might have to push it the next week, but it will be a great time. And Anish is excited because he says, Pastor, I'll get all the attention from you. So I said, okay. Let's do it. Is that right? For those of you who are worshiping with us and are not following the series that I'm doing, Adam Hamilton, who's a pastor of a church in Kansas City, and he uses his book, and he's talking about there are five principal Christian practices. Not that there are others, but he talks about five of them, which during the season of Lent, many of the churches encourage them to do, the five practices. And so he basically is talking about it. So we started off on the first Sunday in Lent. The first one that we talked about is prayer and worship. Prayer and worship. And I said to all of you, worship is not so much we receive, because oftentimes we come here, and when the worship team doesn't do so well, what do you say? The worship was not the greatest today. Because what we are doing is, and I'm not, in a, this happens all the time. I'm not saying it in a bad way, but this happens all the time. Because the reason why we do is we think of worship as something that we need to receive. But worship is oftentimes what you offer to God. Is that right? And so what Adam Hamilton says, those are things that needs to become part of our lives. It needs to become like a practice. And what he says is very interesting. He uses both of his hands, and he makes a fist of one of his hand, and he says, these are some of those things that we do together. And some of those things that we can do on our individual basis. What we do here this morning is this. Is that right? We come together, we worship. But we do it only once a week. What do we do with the rest of the week? Because if we think that once is enough, he says, probably not. And I know you should also understand, I love the way that God creates in 6 days, and then he takes a break on the seventh, isn't it? Because what God reminds us, there are only 6 days that you can do things on your own. For all of you, it's just a very simple reminder. If you can keep going like the way you go, we live in a time, we use this quote-unquote rat race kind of an idea. And God reminds us, there's only 6 days that you can do this rat race. And on the seventh, your body needs it. And so God reminds us, hey, listen, you need to take a break. And that's why you come together and worship. And the writer of Hebrews says, no, don't disregard worship. What has happened during the COVID is, because we were so frightened to come together in person, we have made a virtual understanding of worship, and we got comfortable with worship. We did worship online. And so when we invite you, they say, Pastor, thank you, I'm fine. I watch you on Zoom. But what God reminds us, this one we need to do it when we are together. And then he says, the five fingers are the five times you can do it. What he says, he kind of pushes it a little harder. And he says, we need to do that five times a day. And as I looked at the video and I said, nah, even for me, it's very hard. But what he says is very interesting. He says, see something that's a routine in your life. Yeah, you have a routine. You have a morning coffee, is that right? I don't know, about 11 o'clock you take a break and have a coffee. Or in the evening. So what he says is, think of a routine that happens in your life and then make that a time of worship. And oftentimes we think of worship as coming together like this and singing a song. What he says is there are only two things that you need to do in worship. Number one, you need to say thank you, God. Number two is I love you, God. That's all. So find your routine. If it's only 2 days, if it's only twice a day, fine, that's okay. God doesn't require of you to do five times. What God requires of you is at least two, or at least one. So what he says is, if it want to become a practice, you know, I like walking, but then what happens is one day, 2 days, the third day it gets, but if you don't do it, it really affects you, isn't it? So what he says is the same thing. You have to make it a discipline, you have to make it a practice. So that's why he said, do things together, do things on your own. So that was your first Sunday. The second Sunday, what he said was, sometimes we need to read scripture. Because that's the only way. This is, God reveals God's self in many, many different ways. God reveals God's self in nature, in through life situations, through somebody. Is that right? God reveals. Those are all general revelations. But the more specific and the special revelation is through scripture. This is, you know, God can speak other ways, but he'll always confirm through the scripture. God will speak to you, somebody, and I'll say, like for somebody who said, no, you know, we were wondering whether our son was making the right decision about their job, and we were driving past, and we saw this, aha, that's a sign. Is that right? God speaks. But what he says is, you need to go back to scripture and verify it for yourself. And what he says is, what we do here this morning is we read scripture together. Yeah, we do it together like a fist. But what he says is, you can do it on your own. And I challenged you last week, and I said, I'm not telling you, hey, listen, you need to do 5 days, 5 days a week. Yeah, you can do it. Yeah, kudos to you. But what he basically says is, at least, hey, think of twice or thrice a week. And I said something that was, I didn't want to, when I was looking through the sermon, it's sometimes easy to shame you and tell you, do it. Yeah, we shame, the pulpit has so much power. Instead of shaming you, what I said to you was, hey, make friends with the Bible. If you and I go to the Bible thinking of attacking the Bible, finding something in it, sometimes it won't happen. Look at how you make friends. Sometimes you can, who's your friend? You can hang out with, right? What do you do with your friends sometimes? You don't even talk. You can be with them for hours together and not say anything. That's what you need to do. Do it like five times, maybe not, three times, yeah. But what you need to do is make friends with the Bible. It won't attack you. It's pretty nice. So this morning, I just want to quickly go to the text, and then I'll come to the video that you, if you watched, then we will close. Look at the text for this morning. You can open your Bibles. We'll quickly run through. I know you're thinking, Pastor, it's already 11:25, just finish it. Let me say it in the words of the great King Henry VIII, who married many times, and every time he married one, he always said, I won't keep you for long. That's my promise. I won't keep you for long. Okay. Here we go. After 6 days. Well, what does it mean by 6 days? Because the 6 days before that, Jesus told the disciples, hey, listen, I'm going to Jerusalem, and they're going to crucify me. And Peter says, hey, Jesus, that cannot happen. Jesus says, hey, listen, even if you like it or not, that is going to happen. So Jesus says that because Jesus knew this is exactly what is going to happen. So he's going towards Jerusalem exactly now. So 6 days before that, he says, that's why Matthew says here, hey, after 6 days, Jesus took with him three. This is his inner circle. We talked last week about community, about last when Lenten Bible studies. Jesus chose those 12 ragtag team, is that right? Like Moses said this morning, siblings in Jesus, James and John, Peter and Andrew, there were siblings in Jesus' group. And I asked the group, hey, listen, would you like to, in your small group, would you want your brother or sister there? That's how Jesus picked. Jesus had a tax collector. Tax collectors were hated. Jesus had a zealot. The zealots hated Rome. But Jesus had all of them. And Jesus, out of the 12, picks the three. Is that right? Those are his ragtag team. And there's all those guys. Look at it. James and John, later on, in Matthew's gospel itself, will talk about who wants to sit at the right and the left-hand side of Jesus. Talk about ego. Is that right? Talk about power. Talk about wanting to have more. Talk about sitting in high places. Later on in Matthew's gospel, Peter will say to Jesus, Jesus, I don't even know who you are. Jesus' team, Jesus even today in our church, many churches, Jesus doesn't pick people who are great qualities. But he can make great out of you. Is that right? That's what he did. He picked up 12. The 12 changed the whole world, isn't it? If you and I offer our lives to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, take what I have, Jesus will take you and will turn the upside down. That's God's promise. He will do it. So Jesus takes those 12, and it says he led them up a mountain. As I was listening to a pastor who said, I have been to Holy Land many times. The Mount Tabor is like a chunk of stone right in the middle. And he says, most of them cannot even walk up Tabor, because Tabor is so steep, it's hard to walk. And today, modern day tourists, he says, will take a taxi to go up there. Look at Jesus takes them on a walk, on a hike. You don't know why, isn't it? Takes them on a hike and the high mountains, and there he says he transfigured them. It's the word metamorphosis. Metamorphosis, when a larva becomes a pupa into a butterfly. That's what the word that is used. Jesus metamorphosized, changed something differently. And then it says, his face shone like sun, and the clothes became like white. And then there appeared with them Moses and Elijah. I have often said this. You know, today at least I have a sticker when I go to a meeting which say Kamlesh, pastor. I wonder whether they had a sticker saying Moses, Elijah. How did they recognize? Isn't it? But look at this. Even the sequence is very interesting. It doesn't say Elijah and Moses. It says Moses and Elijah, because in Matthew's gospel, this Jesus is the new Moses. That's what from the beginning he will say. Jesus, when he was, went into Egypt, he came out of Egypt. All of those imageries about Moses. So that's why he says, hey, first Moses and then Jesus. They were talking with Jesus, right? And it says, Peter just said, it is good for us to be here. It's good for us to be here, and if you wish, we'll make three shelters. And again, look at it. It says, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. The other significance is, Moses represented the law. Elijah represented the prophet. Even if you go to a Jewish synagogue this morning, now today we read scripture. Look at the, you know, I don't know if you notice what we do here, but look at when we come here, there is an Old Testament reading, there is a New Testament reading, and there is a gospel, isn't it? It's the same thing that happens in the only thing there in the Jewish synagogue, there won't be a gospel. But there won't be a New Testament, but there will always be one lesson which will be taken from the Torah, the first five books of Moses, and there will be one lesson from the prophets. Just to say that Moses was important, Elijah was important. So when Moses and Elijah appear on that saying, it's just to represent the law and the Moses, which was very significant in the life of the people of Israel. And so they get there, and while he was still speaking, it says a bright crowd covered him, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my son whom I love, with him I am well pleased, listen to him. And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground and were terrified. I love Peter. You know why? He always puts his foot in the mouth. Is that because he's so excited about something that's happening. And what he says to them, hey, Jesus, why don't we build? And so Jesus says, hey, and then after this is over, and it says Jesus came and touched them and said, get up and don't be afraid. And I asked myself, why did Jesus say don't be afraid? Were they terrified to see Jesus this way? Or probably they are thinking, yeah, after this, what is our life going to be? Only Matthew says that Jesus will be called Emmanuel, God with us. Maybe he was reminding, don't be afraid. I will come with you. I will be with you. Let's keep going, and I'm done with this. And as they were coming down the mount, Jesus instructed them not to tell. But before that, look at verse 8. It says, when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. What Matthew wanted to say is, this is very clear. After everything is said and done in this place, after every gospel, every law that is read and the prophet that is read, and the ultimate is Jesus. What we do here is all about Jesus. Everything after the, you know, everything fades away. When the music fades and everything is done, hey, Jesus. That's what Matthew was reminding us. Everything else except Jesus was there. And so look at that. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them not to tell anyone. This is Jesus' fascinating line. This is what is called a messianic secret. When you tell somebody, don't do it, they'll go and do it. Right from the Garden of Eden, isn't it? God says, don't touch it, or you'll touch it. Maybe Jesus had a very good idea, don't tell it, they'll go tell. Because they went and told, probably. Is that right? Now here, this is what I wanted to offer to you as I close this one. I read the text. This text has an amazing movement in it. Beautiful movement. Look at it. There are three things that he said. First he said, he went up. Isn't it? And then it says they wanted to capture it. They want to stay there. And then at the very end, he says they came down. What Matthew was reminding, Jesus took them up for worship. And oftentimes what we are also like Peter. We want to capture this moment because this is a comfortable moment, isn't it? We think to ourselves, this is what we need to do. So we want to capture it, we want to remain. There is always this temptation to remain. It is always this temptation to tell ourselves, hey, this is comfortable, this is what we need to do. We as a church, we need to come together, we need to worship, we need to fellowship, and that's it. Is that right? That's exactly what Peter thought. Let's capture this moment, let's remain here on the mountain. But Jesus reminds them, hey, listen, the task that need to be done is in the valley. We need to go down. Is that right? This is my first thing that I wanted to offer to you. Today's topic is about serving. It's about serving. I don't know if you watched the video. Even after me telling me it's a must-watch video. Isn't it? I said to you, it's a must-watch video. It really is a must-watch video. Because what he says, really what he says is the word serve is mentioned 1,000 times in the Bible. The same, either serve or a cognate of serve, is mentioned 1,000 times. Because what he says is, you and I are created, are formed by God to serve. If you think I am mistaken, go and read for yourself Ephesians 2:10. You know what he says? You are God's masterpiece created in Christ Jesus for good works. That's what it says. You and I are created to serve. Yeah. That's what it is all about. We are created to serve. Now tell me, if you watched that video, what did you get out of it? I love the silence. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, thank you. That's what he says, right? He says small things do wonder. Yeah, what he's saying, I'm not discrediting the big things that God does. Right? Yeah, he's not saying, hey, the big things that God does doesn't matter. No, that's the only thing that matters. No, no, no. What he says is, yeah, that's all happens. But the small things that you and I do. Have you heard of ARC? ARC is, what is it called? Acts of Random Kindness. Don't Google it now, but go when you get home. Go to YouTube and write, do ARC. Acts of Random Kindness. Beautiful videos are there. And it says, there is one video which says, it will make you cry. It really made me cry. You know what? But the reason why I'll tell you, there's only one example to tell you, because there's so many I won't tell you. There's only one example. This kid comes, you know Halloween, right? This kid comes to the door, and there is a basket outside where in some homes, because they are not at home to give the candies, they leave the basket with the candy. Is that right? So this kid so anxiously runs to the, you can see it on this camera. This kid so anxiously runs to the door and looks in, peeps inside, and he turns to his mother and says, Ma, there is no candy. And the mother says, oh, is that so? And you know what this kid does? Takes some from his bag and puts it inside. Acts of random kindness. That's what Jesus was talking about. Oftentimes, what happens is, unless you have something to say about the video, because I'm going to close. Yeah. Acts of random kindness. 2020, for those of you who are new, who are visiting us, who are worshiping with us, 2020, when we started in January, I said to the congregation, this year, in 2020, there are two goals for us. Number one, I said engagement. And number two, visibility. Because what I found, what research tells me is, if you want to make somebody who comes to your church as a visitor to become part of your life, engage them. Is that right? Because you can move from being a visitor to a disciple of Jesus when they get engaged, when they began to do. Second one was visibility. Because I told myself, you know, oftentimes this is with every immigrant church, not AICC. This is with every immigrant church. What happens is we are people who commute. Look at yourself. You commute 30 minutes, right? Most of you commute 40 minutes, 30 minutes to come to here. Many, many immigrant churches have become commuting churches. They come from afar. They come here, worship. They close this place and go away. Until somebody sees us in this community that we are here, nobody knows about it, right? So I told the congregation, hey, listen, this year, what we want to do is to increase our visibility. You know what happened 2020 March? The world got shut down. But see the way God honored us. Our engagement in this church increased by 1,000%. Because we did everything Zoom. There was a team that worked behind the scene. There was a choir that sang and somebody put it together. Angie would send the music, somebody would sing somewhere, everything was put together. Is that right? And then what we saw, look at how God makes engagement possible. Even in the most difficult circumstance. And you know what we did? We put a small pantry outside. We just stacked them week after week with some food. We got noticed by the mayor of Berkeley Heights. We got noticed by the mayor of Plainfield. Talk about visibility. Isn't it? We didn't do big. Those acts of random kindness. The reason why I'm saying is, we are good as a church to meet those, to be in service to the community when a crisis arises. Yeah, we heard about Ukraine. What did we do? Let's collect money. We heard about Turkey. Yes, let's collect money. We heard about Chennai floods. Let's collect money. Is that right? We are very good with crisis. But what God reminds us this morning, crisis is easy to respond. But can we do these acts of random kindness on a regular basis? That's what he's talking about. And he's not talking about those big things. You did it. You did it during the pandemic. You know what you did? When somebody needed food and you knew that person was sick, what did you do? You cooked, you left it at the door, rang the doorbell and walked away. COVID was at its height. You did it. Yeah. When somebody you knew was just shut in, what did you do? You called that number and said on the person on the other line, hey, listen, I want to say hello. You did it. Now, that's what Hamilton says. If we are looking for these big things, what God requires of us are these small acts of random kindness. Do it. And then he says, we can do this stuff as a community, but we can also do this stuff as an individual. And so he says, when I wake up in the morning, I just pray one prayer. Here I am, God, send me. And so he says, God takes those words seriously and he provides me opportunities to be kind to someone. And what he says is, if you and I pray that way, God opens up opportunities for us to do. Yeah. It's amazing how God does that. So my challenge to you is pray about it. Ask God, and God will open up. This is my first thing. Crisis response is great. But what God's desire for us is not crisis, but can we do these acts of serving on a regular basis? You know why? Because God has no plan B. I'm being very serious. Mighty God, God of creation, God who spoke things into being, God who fed 5,000, isn't it? God who stood before the Red Sea and said, be parted, and it parted. A God of mighty acts. Yeah. But that same God has no plan B. Because if you and I say, listen, God, I'm not going to do this, God says, okay. God really doesn't have a plan B. God will use what you have. Your hands, your feet, your little bit, God will use it. Yeah, that's what God says. But listen, the next one is also very important. The next one is that if we don't respond, God sometimes uses somebody outside. Because God cares and loves this world more than you can imagine. God will not wait for you to say, hey, listen, give me some time. If we don't, God will use somebody outside. This is my last one, and I will close. Because today's is about service, isn't it? God calls you to serve. God calls you to serve. And oftentimes, why we need to do these practices of reading the scripture and praying and worshiping and even serving, because we think this is the only way that we can please God. And so what do? Or we say to ourselves, if we really need to be blessed, we need to serve. And so what we make service as a requirement. Your service to the community, your service is a response to what God has already done. Look around you. God has blessed you, isn't it? Yeah. I often say this. My pastor at the old church, he will always say this. He says, when you came into the country, you came with 2 suitcases. But little did he realize that the airlines will not allow to carry more. But you came with 2. Is that right? So what you and I are called to serve God, not because, or not so that, but you will serve because God has already blessed you. Your desire to serve God is only a response. Not a requirement. God doesn't require you. Yeah, God doesn't require you. You will still be blessed. Whether you respond or not, God will still bless you. Don't worry about that. God will take care of you. God will take care of your children. God will take care of every need in your life. Because the God is a promise-keeping God. He's much bigger than that. But what he says to you and to me, hey, listen, serve because I've already done this in your life. Amen. Pray with me. God, we give you thanks. Lord, you have created us to serve you. You really, Lord, you have created and you formed a church so that the church will be hands and feet for you in the world. And Lord, sometimes we respond boldly and sometimes we hesitantly respond to you. And this morning, Lord, in the quietness of our heart, Lord, help us not to miss what you are doing in this world. Not in the grand things, but in the small acts of random kindness. And I pray this morning, oh God, that we will go from this place just with simple one prayer and say to you, God, teach us to be mindful of somebody who you will bring our way. Teach us to be mindful, oh God. And when that happens, oh God, and when we feel the nudge of your spirit to say some encouraging word to them, may we say it, because through that, your kingdom gets established. And so, God, we give you thanks this morning. Lord, I pray for everyone seated in this sanctuary, everyone who listens, and the ones who will listen even after this. Because you love this world more than we can ask or imagine. And you will use us, our gifts, our hands, our feet, to extend your kingdom. And may we say yes. And may you use us as a congregation, as individuals, to extend your kingdom here on earth. God, honor those prayers that we make this morning. We thank you. We bless you. For it is in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Will you stand with me as we close our worship? The words of the song again will appear. It talks about serving. Yesu, Yesu, fill us with your love. Show us to serve the neighbors we have from you. Shall we rise and sing that song? There we go. Yesu, Yesu. Fill us with your love, show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. Kneels at the feet of his friend, silently washes his feet. Master who acts as a slave to them. Yesu, Yesu. Fill us with your love, show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. Neighbors are wealthy and poor, varied in color and race. Neighbors are near and far away. Yesu, Yesu. Fill us with your love, show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. These are the ones we should serve, these are the ones we should love. All these are neighbors to us and you. Yesu, Yesu. Fill us with your love, show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. Loving puts us on our knees, silently washing their feet. This is the way we should live with you. Yes, sir. That when you show us opportunities, oh God, that we will recognize it, and that we will serve you this week and in the days to come. Serve you simply, serve you faithfully, serve you So God, send us from this place with your blessing. Come with us and go before us. For you have called us and you remain faithful. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us this day and forevermore.